Hi, this is Tom, Junkie XL, and welcome to Studio Time Season 2. Today we're going to talk more about string writing, melody writing, and harmonic progression. And as an example, we're going to focus on a cue again from the movie Brimstone, the alternative movie directed by Martin Koolhoven with Guy Pearce, Dakota Fanning, Kit Harington, Carice van Houten. You definitely have to see it. It's a wonderful, wonderful movie. So now I want to talk about a little bit about harmonic progression, how to avoid like very obvious progressions. First, I want to play you a very, very simple melody that is very long, that is reminiscent to the original theme of Liz, and that tutorial you could see prior to this, it aired last week, so you could see there what her theme is and what the reminiscent effect is over here. So let's now open up a string part. I'm actually doing this with LASS, the solo violin. It's a library that I use a lot to map out the lines for a solo violin or for a cello. Let's just play the melody line here and see what the melody line is. So that's the melody line. The notes are really long, and the idea was to switch chords while the melody is holding its line, but in a sexy manner. So let's now go to a string patch and let's talk about this for a second. So the technique that I use here is the technique that's called going from 5 to 1. So let's say we're in A minor. That is a 5-1 progression. But there is an interesting way to do this when you're in a minor chord and you make it major with a dominant 7 in it, and then you transpose to the next one that is dominated by that 5 chord. So let me play that to you. So if I go from, let's say we're now in F minor, so now we've transposed, so we were in F minor, it became major with the dominant 7, and we're going to now B flat minor. So we've now transposed from F to B flat minor, 5-1. But there's a sexier way of playing that. When instead of playing the dominant 7 in your top part, but if you're playing it in your low part, then you get a really interesting transition. And then when you land somewhere, instead of like playing the root of the 1, you're actually playing a different inversion of that chord. So a lot of talking, let's just play it. So we're in F minor, and instead of playing this, I'm gonna do this. So that sounds a whole lot interesting. But what if we did an inversion on the chord that we land on. So we go from F minor, F major, dominant 7, and then we go to B flat minor. But what if we did play an inversion of the B flat minor? So we're in F minor again. That sounds a whole lot more interesting. So we're playing the F minor in root position. F major with the dominant 7 in the bass, and then we go to, which is B flat minor with the 3rd in the bass. And then after that, let's go back to the C and make that a dominant 7, and then we can go back to F, and then the circle is round. So let's just play that again. So we start with our F, F minor, F major with the dominant 7 in the bass, B flat minor with the 3rd in the bass, C sus with the 7 already there, and we're back to F. But even when we land on the C part, we can do something interesting. And it's very similar to what we do on the F. So when I play the sus chord on the C, let's play the dominant 7 in the bass as again. So the bass keeps going down. So let's try that. And so instead of playing instead of that, we're going to play this. So let's now play the whole cycle again. F minor. F major with the 7 in the bass. B flat minor with the 3rd in the bass. C sus, C dominant with the 7 in the bass, and we land on F. But why would we stop there? Why don't we keep this system going, and instead of going why are we not playing another inversion on the F? So that would sound like this. Our C, sus chord, dominant, with the 7 in the bass. So now we're playing the F minor with the 3rd in the bass. So the bass keeps ascending stepwise while we're constantly playing the similar chords. So let's go all the way from the top. I'm going to play it one more time without talking, and then we're going to play it again with me talking. So this feels like a really nice stepwise progression down. And I didn't come up with this myself. Bach did that for us, and we can learn from it every day. The brilliant composer that taught us how to use these things in the most effective way. So now I'm going to play this again. I'm going to talk through it to tell you exactly what this chord progression is. And the only chords that I'm playing is F, B flat, C. F, B flat, C. But I do change modes. I go from minor to major, from minor to major. But technically, that's not transposing in the classical sense. That is borrowing from a neighbor tonality. It's technically the same. C minor and C major is the same key. Yes, there are different notes and it has a different feel, but it is the same key. So let's now play it again. We're in F minor. F major, dominant 7 with the 7 in the bass. B flat minor with the 3rd in the bass. C sus 4. C dominant with the 7 in the bass. F minor 9 with the 3rd in the bass. Resolve to F minor with the 3rd in the bass. C sus 4 with the G in the bass. C dominant 7 with the 5th in the bass, the G. And we resolve to F. So one really important thing when you do these kinds of transitions is that when the bass plays the 3, the 3rd of the chord, so it's the first inversion, you cannot double, or you can, obviously, but you should not double that 3rd in the upper voices because that takes the magic away. So when you play F, F dominant 7, so now we're playing the B flat chord with the 3 in the bass, but it has a really nice quality to it, and that is because the 3 is not doubled in the upper voices. If I would do that, it wouldn't sound as nice. This has a really nice quality to it. So this is roughly the chord progression that I went for with this piece. So let's now open our strings here. And I'm just gonna play the program strings right here. So there's a little chord progression that goes that happens before we get to this thing that we just figured out. And let me just play that to you. And then we'll talk afterwards. So this is exactly what I talked about. So once we get to bar 515, that's when it starts playing that chord progression. And as we talked about before in episode 1, when I was playing this harmonic progression, I was not really playing melody lines for the strings. I was playing a patch. And since I'm a bad piano player and playing on the keyboards, I cannot play the same thing that I would really love to play what you see here on the screen. So now we actually do see melody lines, and you see it feels way more smoother and way more alive and way more emotional when it's played like that. But the harmonic backbone of this section that I just talked about is what I played with the patch, and that was just for instructional purposes. But now we actually hear how it sounds. I'd love to play this section again with the violin line, the melody line on top. So you could see how the harmony is changing as the violin line stays on the same note. So let's play this again. There you have it. So the melody line, what is so nice is that the melody line hangs on a note and there's these harmonic progressions going on underneath where the melody line is a part of as a chord member, one of the notes of the chords. And it gives a really extra emotional quality to it. And I think this trick is an interesting trick to expand your harmonic palette, and it really feels, you know, that classical Hollywood approach, very Italian Ennio Morricone. It's a technique that I really love to use. So now the cue continues, and I want to talk about that a little bit more. So when the cue continues, we hear all kinds of bits from Liz's main theme. So let's just play the violin. And it's not the literal theme, but it really reminds you strongly of it. And the harmony underneath is completely different than the original theme that I've showed to you in tutorial one. There are a lot of chord inversions that I just showed you. It's the same kind of tricks from going from minor to major with the dominant seven in the bass. What we started in the first part continues in the second part, but now it's kind of merged with Liz's original theme. So let's just play her original theme. And it starts right here. So, in the build-up, we already feel the resemblance of her theme, and then at bar 532, it actually starts playing the theme. And when we actually get to the final recording, it's so nice to hear the strings go really into the stratosphere, the C6, which is so incredibly high, and the way that they played it, but we get to that later. Let's open up all the strings here, and let's just see what the harmony is doing. Let's just play it and we'll talk after that. So there's a lot going on here. So let's open up a piano patch. So that movement, you constantly find that coming back here. So let's just focus on, we just played the melody, but look at these purple puppies, which are the violas. And then we hear a bit of that also in the second violins and in the cello. But I want to focus on the viola, and I'm just really going to zoom in. The da, 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 da. I'm a terrible singer, by the way. So when I sing something, it's insane. But anyway, the point comes across. It's the da, ba, da, 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 da. I constantly use that as a counterline to remind ourselves this is her theme, like almost... too much, but it works so well with the main melody line that has that also that little shape in there. So let's just listen again and see. Oh, you know what? Let's just do this solo. So this is like a naked down version of this. So we're just hearing the main melody line, the second violin, and then the violas and the celli that play the melody too. So I'm not even sure if this makes sense, but then at least you can hear way better how many times that viola is actually echoing that little melody. Let's just see. So we see on multiple spots, da 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 dum, da 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 dum, it echoes this little figure. I'm in a completely different key here, so I'm messing this up a little bit. But you know what I'm understand, what I mean. Da 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 dum, it constantly echoes it throughout this piece while the main melody is playing. So one more time, let's play it with all the strings, and then after that I would love to talk a little bit about what I did with the live recording, and then I'd love to play the full final result, and then that's pretty much it. Okay, so let's play that second section one more time with all the strings on. Thank you. One thing I want to point out, which I really like at the end, is when we're almost getting to the end, and instead of like playing the proper C minor and then the G major, we're actually staying on G, and we play the C minor in the second inversion on G, which will sound like. It makes it so much more dramatic. Instead of. Anyway. Little things I like. So now I'd like to switch on the live recordings. So we have one track that is the full string section and one track that is the solo violin that we listened to in the beginning. And then halfway through the recording, I had this idea. And I said to the solo violinist, why don't you take the top part of the string and just play along with it an octave higher. And she did that, and it sounded great. And then on the spot, we changed a couple of melody spots. So we changed the melody on a few bits here and there. So I don't actually have MIDI of that to replicate. But you'll see how powerful it is when she comes in and she starts playing the top violin line as a soloist, and then we changed a couple of notes. So let's now play the whole thing from the beginning. I'm just going to open up the MIDI so you can actually see what is going on here, and we're listening to our result. And I'm not going to talk. Thank you. And you see how nice it is that that solo violin comes in at the very end to double that first line of the violin. It gives like so much more emotion to it. I hope you really enjoyed watching this tutorial, string writing part two, tutorial two. And I hope to see you on the next tutorial on Studio Time with Junkie XL. Thanks for watching.